Welcome to the another laboratory of fluid mechanics. Today the experiment which we are dealing is the performance of reciprocating pump. So reciprocating pump, pumps are always used to lift the fluid or to transport the fluid from one place to another. Basically, there are two kinds of pump. One is turbo pump and another is positive displacement pump. Under the turbo pump comes the centrifugal pump. Once again, there are classification in centrifugal. Under the positive displacement, there are different kinds of pump, one among which is the reciprocating pump. So also we have vane pumps, gear pumps, screw pumps. Under the positive, the very commonly used positive displacement pump is reciprocating pump. So let us see the construction of the reciprocating pump and let us try to understand. So the basic structure is as similar as to an IC engine. You can see the crank, connecting rod, piston, and also we have got valves. Here the valves are actuated by the level of pressure it is experiencing. There are two valves, one is suction and another is delivery, or I can say it as inlet valve and outlet valve. So the application of reciprocating pump is required wherever the outflow fluid's pressure needs to be very high. Suppose if I say if the head of the building is too very large, then we go for reciprocating pump. Or if there is a very high pressure fluid flow which is required, then also we go for reciprocating pump. The very one simple example is the service station where the car and every other automobile is washed. So here we have already said there is an inlet and outlet valve. When the piston moves from TDC to BDC, because of the suction affects or makes the inlet valve to open so that it can suck the fluid from the source and the cylinder will be filled. Once the piston reaches the BDC, by the time the suction process is completed, the suction valve automatically closes. When the piston starts to move from BDC to TDC, because of the pressurization of the fluid, a little increment in pressure of the fluid will make the outlet valve or the delivery valve to open just by sensing the pressure. So there is no cam mechanism here, just the pressure itself takes the responsibility of opening and closing both of the valves. So the pressurized fluid will there be pumped to the place wherever it is. So here the crank is connected to a pulley where in turn it is connected to a motor with the help of a V-belt. So the rotary motion is there afterwards converted into reciprocating motion. So in this reciprocating pump we have two types, one is single acting and the other is double acting. Here in single acting, only one side of the piston will be coming in contact with the working fluid, whereas in double acting, both the sides of the piston will be coming in contact with the working fluid. Suppose if I say this is the double acting, here also two valves comes into place, and when the piston is moving this side, on the left hand side it will be a pressurization, on the right hand side it will be the suction. And when the piston is coming from left to right, the right side becomes the pumping side, the left side becomes the suction side. So the equipment what we have in our laboratory is double acting pump, that is the piston comes in contact with the working fluid on both the sides. So that is the understanding of the construction of the equipment. So what all needs to be understood? The main performance is the pump is to create flow or to enhance the fluid energy. So for this to happen, we need to provide certain amount of mechanical energy. Among the provided energy, how efficiently the pump is increasing the fluid energy, if we take the ratio of the fluid energy gained by the liquid divided by the mechanical energy input to the pump, this will give the pump's efficiency. So that is the overall efficiency. And also we need to calculate what will be the volumetric efficiency. That means, in other words, what will be the slippage and other parameters. So here we need to find out efficiency, volumetric efficiency. So what all are required? Just we have made a note of it. So we have taken 3 trials so that we get the profile while we are drawing on the graph. The very first parameter we have written is the RPM. So at what RPM the pump is running, that should be noted. Then obviously the pump will experience 2 different pressures. That is, the pump inlet will experience the suction pressure, the pump's outlet will experience the delivery pressure. So delivery head or delivery pressure, it is denoted as capital HD, and the meter in which we are taking the reading of delivery head, the meter's unit is in kg per centimeter square. So we will take the reading in terms of kg per centimeter square, and then putting the conversion formula, we will get it in meters of H2. So there is a formula for it which converts the kg per centimeter square into meters of H2. Similarly, the suction head, which is denoted as HS, is also be noted. So the suction head will be on the meter's tube will be tapped to the suction side. So it gives us the reading in terms of mm of Hg, which we should later convert it into meters of H2. So the speed, the delivery head, the suction head, so these are the 3 very basic input parameters out of which we can be evaluating. Along with that, we also need to know what is the flow rate or what is the amount of flow rate the pump is inducing. So for that we need to calculate. We have a reservoir tank or the filler tank. In that filler tank we will be knowing the cross section area of the filler tank, and by knowing the cross section area, so if I take 5 centimeters or 10 centimeters as the level to be raised, and in that rising time what is the amount of time which has consumed, suppose to raise the level of the tank by 5 centimeters, what is the time consumed, that we will be writing over here. Either we can take 5 centimeters or we can take 10 centimeters, it is up to our comfortability. Okay. Thereafter, once I know the volume, by knowing the rise of the tank, I will know what is the volume accumulated and the time required for the volume accumulation. By knowing these 2 things, I can find out what is the flow rate. Next, I also need to know what is the amount of electricity which is being supplied to the motor. The motor is in turn running the pump. So to know the input mechanical energy, I am indirectly calculating the input mechanical energy by knowing the electrical energy which has been consumed by the motor. Suppose if the motor is consuming 100 units of energy, by the time it gets converted to mechanical energy, it might be probably 85 to 90. So what I will be considering as a mechanical engineer is the 90 units of energy has been fed to pump, and what is the amount of fluid energy which has got converted, that is the ratio of what I am supposed to take to find the efficiency of the pump. So that is why input kilowatt, input energy in terms of kilowatt and output energy in terms of kilowatt, the ratio of these two will give the efficiency of the pump. So by understanding the required parameters, why it is required, now we can start up with the experimentation. Okay, after going through the introduction of the experiment, now we have arrived nearby the experimental setup. So we can also see here the name of the test rig has been written, reciprocating pump. Let us identify few of the parts in this particular test rig. So the very highlighted thing is we can see the collecting tank. Here the riser level has been mentioned. So already we have discussed that we will be taking the water level to be raised is 20 centimeters. We can take also even 10 centimeters. So after the collecting tank, this is required to calculate the volumetric flow rate, actual volumetric flow rate. Next is we have the suction pump, which is connected to the inlet of the pump, and we can see it in two units. The outer scale is in mm of Hg, the outer scale is in mm of Hg, and the inner scale is in inch of Hg. So we will be taking the outer scale reading. Here this is the delivery side meter. Once again there is only one unit scale, whereas here there was two unit scale. The outside was of different unit, the inside was of different unit. Here there is only one unit scale, and this unit scale is showing in terms of kg per centimeter square, which will be later converting this into equivalent meters of H2O. So here we have the specification list where the capacity of the motor, pump, the RPM, the pressure gauge indicators, every other, and the electricity meters, every specification has been mentioned. So here we have the display of RPM of the motor. Next, here we have the energy meter. So going around the experimental setup to see the reciprocating pump. So here this is the prime mover, which is the electric motor. This is the pulley, which has four stages of different speeds combination. So if I belt to a larger pulley, the speed reduces. If I belt to a smaller one, the speed increases. So here will be the crank, here is the connecting rod, and here it is a double acting reciprocating pump. So here is the accumulator. We can see the connecting rods movement here. Okay, this is the accumulator. So here is the wire which is taking the reading of the tachometer to the digital display. So here we have the suction pipe. Here we have the delivery. This is the pipe which is taking to the delivery pressures display. So this is the suction pipe. From the footwall, it is connected to the accumulator by the suction pipe. Next, from the accumulator, it is going to the delivery side. And this is the valve which is to be operated to vary the delivery head. When the valve is totally open. Now it is totally open. Now the delivery pressure will be to the least level. As we close, the valve closes, and this is how we can increase the delivery pressure. Next, we can start the experiment by first, before starting the experiment, we should make sure the delivery valve is completely open. If it is completely closed and if the device is switched on, then it can damage the entire setup, so it should be always kept open. After taking the results from the experimental setup, after noting down the results, we have listed up the results in the tabular column, and also we have done the calculation which is required. So the entire tabular column has been already filled up. So we can see here the very basic parameter what we can vary is the delivery head, and how it can be varied, it is by changing the position of the valve, the flow control valve, which is on the delivery side. As I take the valve's position to the closer side, the head increases. This is how I am varying the delivery head. So just by rotating the valve to the side of the closure, so that means if the valve is totally open, 3/4 open, half open, quarterly open, that means as the valve closes, the head increases. So that is how I am varying the parameter. Nothing else I am varying. So at the very first position, the valve is totally open. At that time, the head what I am getting is 1.4, and in meters of H2O, I am getting it as 14. So the suction head what I am getting is 50, and once it is converted into meters of H2O, what we are getting is 0.86. So the summation of suction head, meters of H2O, plus delivery head, which is in meters of H2O, both summated, we will be getting, you can see here, 14 plus 0.68, we will be getting the total head. The total head is the summation of both the individual heads. And for the time which is required to rise the water level by 5 centimeters is what we have taken into consideration. That is taking nearly 16.56 seconds for the rise of 5 centimeters of water. Next, the actual flow rate after solving the equation, we can see the equation over here. The very first equation is the equation to calculate total head. The second equation is to find the flow rate which has been induced by the pump, where area is the cross section area of the collecting tank, x is the height which we are considering. I said 5 centimeters, it is actually, sorry, 20 centimeters. It is, we have taken 20 centimeter rise, and T1 is the time which is required to raise the level of water by 20 centimeters. So by doing this, we have got the Q actual, and the Q actual which has come out is 6.88 into 10 to the power of minus 4 meter cube per second. Next, what we have taken is, this is the information, or this is the data which helps us in finding the input energy, the quantity of input energy, or the flow rate of energy. Here, for the disc to rotate twice, this is the amount of time which has been taken. So there is an energy meter in which there is a disc, mechanical disc, which is revolving. For the disc to make two complete rotations, it has taken 52.03 seconds. So during the time of experimentation, a stopwatch will be given to calculate the time taken for the disc to rotate for two complete revolutions. The same stopwatch will also be used to calculate the time required to rise the level of water by 20 centimeters. Next, once I get the time 2, I will be substituting here into the formula of input energy, where n is the number of rotations which has been taken as 2, and 3600, it is 1 hour, it is expressed in terms of seconds, and this is the mechanical efficiency of the motor, that is theta m, which has been already given in the observation, which is 0.75, and k is the energy meter constant, which has been taken as 200, and also it has been prescribed on the test rig, and T2 is the time taken for 2 complete rotations, that is 52.03 seconds. So after calculating this, we came out with the input energy as 0.518 kilowatt. So each and every second, 0.518 kilojoules of electrical energy is consumed, that is 0.510 kilojoules of energy per unit time, that is 1 second, has been consumed. Next is the output energy. To find here, W is the specific weight, Q actual we have already found out by making use of collecting tank, rising water level and time. Next, net is the delivery, net is the total net, which is the summation of delivery and suction head. So 1000 we are dividing, so that the output energy comes out also in terms of kilowatts. Next is efficiency, output by input, that is the output energy is the fluid energy, or the energy which has been enhanced in the fluid, that is the output energy is coming in the form of fluid energy, the input energy is going in the form of mechanical energy. So the ratio of these two, so that is what is the overall efficiency of this particular reciprocating pump, which is coming out to be 19.1%. So the same thing has been repeated for another 2 different trials. Just by varying the delivery head, rest of everything gets varied. And to vary the delivery head, we need to close the valve from 3/4 to half to quarter. So by doing so, we get an incremental value of delivery head. Why? Because the valve is blocking the flow of water which is being created or induced by the pump. This closure of valve, as it is resisting the flow of water, the pressure at the delivery end of the pump increases. This is the only way how we can increase the delivery head. So we have taken other 2 trials. So we can also see that as the delivery head increases, there is nothing has changed on the suction side. So the suction side is unaffected by the change in the delivery head or closure of the delivery side valve. So it is not getting affected. So all the values on the suction side for all the 3 trials is same, or it will almost remain same. So the next thing is, here time taken for the water level to rise is little bit increasing. Why? Because as the valve obstructs the flow of water, the flow rate is also getting affected. So again, as the flow rate is getting reduced for more and more closure of the valve, that means to say, if the delivery head is to be increased, more and more closure of the valve is making the flow rate to reduce. So the time is taking more and more. That means to say, the flow rate is getting reduced. Okay. As we have seen here, the time is getting more and more consumed. You can see here, the flow rate is reducing. Why? Because the time consumption is more for the same level of water to rise. Next is, if we see the energy meter, as the head is increased by the closure of the valve, there needs to be a more amount of work which is to be done by the motor and then on the pump. So we can see the time is getting reduced. The time is reducing means there is more consumption of energy, so only the time is getting reduced. So we can also see here the input power is getting increased. So as the time reduces here, the input power increases and the output power also varies proportional to the input power. And if we take the ratio of the input and output power, we can see the efficiency of the pump tends to increase as the head increases or as the resistance to flow increases. So more the head, more will be the efficiency of the reciprocating pump. Whereas in a centrifugal pump, the things gets in the inverse fashion. That means it becomes vice versa. As the head increases, it loses its efficiency. Whereas in reciprocating pump, as the delivery head increases, the efficiency also tends to increase. So that is what we have concluded or tried to understand from the graph. We can see that as the head is increasing, the flow rate is reducing, and as the head is increasing, the efficiency is increasing. That means in a positive displacement pump, not only in reciprocating, most of the other positive displacement pump, as the head increases, the volumetric flow rate tends to reduce, and as the head increases, the efficiency tends to increase. Saying this, we are concluding this experiment.